Every one of our questions that came from our online audience have already been answered. So we're just going to take questions from our live audience here. So if you have a question to direct to our panel, please go ahead.
I have a question. You know, being a workers' comp injury, and I'm sure other people are in a similar situation, and these IMEs that we have to go to, where we are berated and told it's in our head. You know, they do a couple things, and we know we're sick, but they're documenting that we're not. We're somatological, or there's no RSD, and they're lying. You know, they're outright lying. Any thoughts of how we can approach this without becoming more stressed and having flares and how to protect ourselves? Any thoughts?
Yes, I do. Documentation is if it's not documented, it doesn't matter. It's not real, or it leaves open anything that anyone else wants to say. So, in your own, that you know, you have you contribute to your own medical record. I love the you know, in the digital age now, how easily we can incorporate photography, video, into our medical records, and it's irrefutable.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I mean, they can still, it just gives you more ammo against that kind of practice, because if, you know, for one thing, they might not be lying and say that you don't have something, but it's because they just have no clue.
Right.
Sometimes you're going to get an IME by somebody who's never really seen our, never had a patient, never took care of someone over a long period of time, who has RSD. And so clearly you have to have more to back up your claim here, and that's what this is. We're talking about a claim. So make sure your medical record is got as much, you know, if there's visual, as much visual evidence as you could possibly get in there, so that you can't just leave it to someone's narrative what's going on.
From a coping perspective,
yes,
and just, you know, with work comp, with litigation, we see over and over such a, you know, I mean, the trial that comes from that just as a human being. And for anyone to go through that without a health condition would be traumatic. Some people don't get better until their trials are over, because it's like your whole life is on hold. And so remembering to structure in, we have to structure and schedule self-care, because we will be in survival mode and we'll forget about ourselves in the process. And it's so demoralizing to be, to have something like that going on. It's demoralizing. It's like, it's, you know, not being heard, not being understood, and then having your care in jeopardy because of that type of situation. To be, we want to be like all heroes in this and like, oh, we can cope with all of it, but we can't. We can't, and no one should be going through it alone. And when we hit the wall, we want to remember what types of things keep me healthy and keep me whole as I'm going through this. Am I going to need more support? Maybe I have an appointment coming up, or a really horrible appointment, something I'm not looking forward to. What can I carve into my life, in my relationship, so that we can kind of go through it together and take the sting out of it? And noticing, how do we sabotage ourselves when we're in that environment? We have a responsibility too. So what is my, you know, I might have an MO sometimes, maybe I avoid it, maybe I don't open my mail, maybe I don't, you know, because, you know, all of this is happening. You want to stay on top of that and make sure you've got a good support system going through.
And realize that it's the IME's job to try to discredit you, you know. A lot of times that's all they do, is IMEs all day long. So they, like Dr. Mitch said, they don't know how to treat a patient. They don't know what to look for. They're just, they get paid to write down that they don't see anything. That's the defense. That's what they have the IME there for. So try not to take it so personally.
Just for example, I had one last week, and the doctor came in and immediately said to me, 85% of RSD patients go into remission. So I at first was shocked. I said, I'd like to see where you're quoting that from. Of course, he never provided it. But, you know, that's just the beginning. And I have been told by one of my legitimate doctors to report these guys to the American Medical Association or the American Psychiatric Association. You know, if you have good paperwork and they miss things or they outright lied, they're just to document that and report them.
I just wanna say something, I was with Nancy on that IME, I met with her as her caretaker. And Nancy was upset by it, and I said, what do they call the doctor who graduates last in medical school?
Doctor.
Doctor. And so, I'm pushing a lighter note, but I wanna say it was a great presentation, and I've been on the other side of this pain issue for the last 30 years in medical sales, in pain management. And then I went on and developed chronic pain conditions that I'm dealing with. And I just wanna share some things from my experience as a medical sales representative calling on pain doctors and some of the challenges that patients went through. And I always tried to do whatever I could to help the doctors, help the patients. But when the doctors ask about, you know, where are you on the pain scale, I always say, you know, with meds or without meds, you know, because that goes in your chart and can become fodder for a denial of a claim or something. Also, when you have to make that phone call about what you were saying about, you know, the cost, you know, wait for the bill to come and pay your portion of it. If you call it Friday, 4:45 p.m., you're more likely to get the person to say yes because they want to get out of there. So, it's another trick that I learned.
It works.
You know? And when you're at the doctor's, you can ask them if there are any new clinical trials that they're aware of. And sometimes that seems to get the doctor to open up and talk more. And if there are, you can now network with more people, get involved in newer treatments, et cetera. And many of those may be free. So just a couple of things.
Thank you.
Just one small thing on the last statement about the participating in a trial and, you know, being free, but then remember there's placebo and, you know,
yes,
treatment, so you might be getting nothing for free.
Keep
that in mind.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Anyone?
I have some questions about the Palmar a little bit more.
Sure.
And, because I'm new to it. Obviously it takes more than one treatment.
Yes.
How often do those have to be done?
Thank you.
Some of those.
I'm glad you asked, because that's very, that's a good question. So, like I mentioned how on the very first treatment, if we can't, you know, get the pain zeroed out, it might not be something that's, you know, that works for that person. However, if we do get it zeroed out, I can tell you that day you're gonna expect your pain to come back, as if it was like a TENS unit where it's a temporary relief. However, it's with continued treatments, and so the standard protocol is 10 treatments, 5 consecutive days, weekend, 5 consecutive days. The treatments take 45 minutes to an hour, you know, from the time you walk in our door to the time you're gone, it's an hour, 10 minutes or something. And it's non-invasive, you know. You based on where it's at, you wear the appropriate clothing, you know, so that, you know, it's easy to access the areas. And but 10 treatments is the standard protocol that the experience, and even in the literature now with studies showing that the pain relief you get from the from that 10 treatment trial could last, you know, for about 12 weeks or 3 months. And booster treatments will then, if you respond the first time, you typically will respond again. And you don't need usually 10 booster treatments to get back to a tolerable or to zero out pain. And then subsequent remissions are longer. So, so far, so it's looking like with continuing boosters at some point, there could be a you know, a point where people are coming back very infrequently.
Every patient responds to it.
That's for sure.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience with it?
Sure. I'm a CalMar patient. I have been since September of 2012. and my experience is different than that. I had these 10 treatments, and it did not take me to zero while I was not connected, but it did reduce my pain significantly to where I would stay between 2 and 4. At first, I would stay between 2 and 4 for upwards of 6 to 8 weeks, and then I would return for boosters. My sweet spot for boosters is 4. 2 seems to irritate it and make me flare up. And anything more than 4 is kind of overkill. Keep in mind, it takes RSD a while to train your brain to be in that much pain. So it takes it a while to retrain it. It takes Palmer a while to retrain it to not be in pain. So the more treatments I have, the longer the duration of lower pain. So now I'm to the point where I go about 14 weeks between treatments, and I do have periods of 0. treatments, I'll go 5 days. I complete 0, which feels like a trip to Aruba. It's amazing. I mean, I can't even explain how amazing it is to be at 0. I appear in chronic pain, feeling normal again, is priceless. So I do stay at 0 for about 5 days, and then when I usually return for boosters when I get back up to about a 6, because if I wait until it gets too high, it seems like the 4 boosters don't really contain the beast. It doesn't fully cage it. It just sedates it a little bit. So if I go back when I'm at about a 6, I can fully cage the beast and go about 14 weeks.
But Kelmar is not approved for insurance coverage for RSD, right? Or is it?
Mine covers it 100%.
Okay.
Yeah,
it just depends on the insurance.
You know,
yeah.
it's kind of like any 2 passengers on an airplane don't pay the same price for the ticket.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a good thing.
I might ask your insurance company.
I didn't think it was approved for anybody. But.
No, but it is.
Yeah,
we are very, how do you say, we're taking a lot of action to try to, if they're not covering, we don't take that lightly.
Okay.
And we're figuring out how to get them to do the right thing.
More and more covered every day, so you just need to check yours.
Okay, what's the lead time to get into to your facility?
About 20 minutes, why?
Well, take that!
So, I mean, like, we call the office Monday morning.
Typically, with a week or two.
Okay, so I'm just thinking about how Gracie was saying, you're trying to figure out when to go back to the boosters.
Right.
Didn't know if you have to, okay, I'm ready for a booster.
No.
Oh, guess what, you have to wait
on. No.
Okay.
Listen, I think that we'd be happy to have that problem, and then I think we would get another machine.
Right, okay. Fair enough. I have a Kalmar question. What's the longest that somebody has had RSD that you've been successful in?
That's a good question. And Norm, who's my, remember I told you about Norm, who's like, he's a better doctor than me, so I wish he was listening, but he's talking to people in the booth, but because he has such a handle on our patient population, because he talks, he keeps relationship long beyond, when they're done to get this kind of information. But I am thinking, just to go off the top of my head, I mean, it's almost like I'm thinking in terms of the briefest I've ever seen. There's someone who had it for like a month, but that was so unusual. I mean, typically it's 2 years plus by the time I'm seeing them.
Have you treated anybody that's had it for 25 years plus?
I personally know of a patient from our Midwest group that had it for 18 years.
That we treated with Kelmar?
I've had it for 9, and I had Kelmar in June. It's just the initial time in June, and it helped with that.
I don't know if that's the longest. I just personally know.
Yes.
One.
So.
For 2005, so I've had 9 years. Sorry.
Thank you. And there was good result. I mean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Immediately after, when I got home, I slept a lot when I was there, but I was feeling so much better that I actually bought a tennis racket.
Oh wow.
And tennis shoes. He bought a tennis racket, and I don't play like I used to. But it's nice to be able to just hit the ball around with my 6-year-old daughter. Just, I mean, lightly. But, yeah. I'm more physically active now than I was.
Yes, sir.
Why are there so few Kalmar places
It's a good question. Not everyone's is not everyone has the foresight that my partner Norm does to see something like this as a good investment and to do it. I think medicine in general, the whole body of medicine is extremely conservative. And so I think that's primarily the answer to the question, is that it takes a long time for things to show their benefit before it gets widespread use.
What do you do if insurance doesn't cover it? Do you do payments or something like that?
Yes, work it out, so to speak.
Question.
Cheryl?
I'm just curious if you know anything documented that CRPS can lead to significant irreversible tissue damage or immediate threat to organs, which can then in case result possibly in death. It's more about the irreversible tissue damage or threat to organs.
So I want to qualify this by saying, I'm gaining tremendous amount of experience now with CRPS. Remember, I'm 27 years in practice, 25 of those, really, I didn't see CRPS. So now I'm inundated with CRPS, which is nice. So so I'm not an expert in this clinically, to qualify my answer. But with that said, I believe that's a little overstated about the the damage and irreversibility. Again, from my own experience, there are people who've had long-term, a lot of pain for a long time, even swelling, redness, but yet I haven't seen anyone who's, who lost a limb, or had that in their clinical history.
What's your head?
Yeah. Yeah.
I've never seen one.
No, you're okay. First person.
All right.
There you go.
All right. Well, obviously. No, and I appreciate that. And I'm saying, obviously, I see a skewed population because of the fact that, and it's unfortunate that I see a skewed population. I think the fact that what really I embraced about this was the do no harm is why I got on board. I'm thinking, okay, how could I at least not look at this further, because we're not talking about such a risky proposition here. I must look at it. And now that I have looked at it and have been convinced that it's of use, I wait for the time that it's going to be a while, but it should be, I think, first off, in my clinical opinion, it's not something we should wait. I don't think it's something, it just makes sense when there are non-invasive and invasive treatments for the same process. We would want to exhaust all the non-invasive before going invasive. And so I think this speaks to the idea of earlier the better. That we could do something like that.
So many people out there that have it internally in their organs. So is that not a threat to the organs? RSD can lead to a threat of.
I'm going to actually say that I on this panel, I don't have the expertise to give you an answer.
It affects my internal organs, so. I haven't been in a position for something to fail,
sure.
But I do have cardiac ischemia, I have intestinal ischemia, kidney stones, but that was due to the medications. But once you start producing it, it was forevermore. Once you start producing kidney stones, your body just keeps on going, so it's another thing I live with. But I forgot your question. So it does definitely affect the organs. I've never heard of a patient dying from it, and I've talked to thousands of RSD patients over the years. But that doesn't mean that it hasn't happened or.
Sure.
Yeah.
Is this for my Ontario
support
for coverage.
Okay.
For them even wanting to cover anything.
Oh, it has to be life threatening or organ threatening to get coverage.
Loss of
gathering information.
Oh, that's huge.
Yeah, I mean, like with my
intestines, right
there's a whole section that doesn't get blood. And so they wanted to cut that out. And so two sections that do get blood together to fix it. So there's parts that are affected and die. I don't know, and my gallbladder died, but I don't know if it was because of RSD or because of my gallbladder.
That's the problem that they're having with that. If you looked on the other scope of it and take dementia, for example, you know, when your brain shuts down, your organs shut down. They don't say cause of death dementia, they say cause of death heart attack, or, you know, so it's the same thing with RSD. I have full organ involvement as well, and I take as many medications to help me go to the bathroom, to help my stomach from exploding and throwing up, and I mean, it's extremely painful, but I mean, I couldn't have, probably over the 30 years that I've had the disease, I was probably rushed by ambulance to the hospital 15 times for heart attack symptoms, and get there and there's nothing wrong. Like, oh, everything's fine, you know.
Are you currently doing something that is making you look as healthy and well?
As healthy as I can, yes, right up here.
Okay.
Positive attitude. Awesome.
Yeah.
You gotta have a positive attitude.
Well.
Yeah. You gotta get up every morning and you just gotta move, you know? Because, you know, you'll go back to bed that night and you can go, oh, you know? So, but, you know, you just have to move. And you, in the beginning, it was nothing like I am now. You know, you just have to, make a decision. Is it time for me to suffer or live? You know, eliminate that word suffer. You live with RSD, you don't suffer with RSD. You eliminate the word disability. You're not disabled, you're able. Those are the things that you have to put in your mind. So when you use your head, like, it's all in your head, that needs to be in your head. You need to run with that positive attitude. I've had 40 major surgeries, you know, because I didn't know. Oh, we'll cut this, we'll do that, we'll snap this, we'll put this in there, and it just spread off.
With each procedure?
Every single time, yep.
Me too.
Every single time.
See, a lot of heads shaking on that one.
Well, I appreciate, thank you
yeah.
for that.
But sure.
Thank you.
I can see I'm here to learn.
That's great.
I appreciate it.
Credits?
Yes, I have a question. Recently I read or heard somewhere that there's a test, a blood test, that RSD may show, or there's a causal relationship between autoimmune disorders that show up in blood serum concentrations.
There's two autoantigens or antibodies in our blood that they're finding. Some people have one of them, some people have both of them. Mm-hmm. And if you go to BarbieEngle.com, I have the article of the research study that they found that over in Liverpool and also in Canada, that they're working on, well, they have the blood test there. They're working on getting it here. Power Pain Foundation is actually working with a lab in California right now to try to get the test here.
Great.
So hopefully it will be soon, but soon in the medical world could be five to 10 years. Yeah, but have hope.
I'm just curious on that, on the idea of there being some laboratory documentation to what the, you know, I just want to make actually a point about it, is that I think in some ways it's obviously it's a good thing. I mean, there's good, but in some ways it's good for the wrong reasons. For instance, like you have to, you know, now you have to have that test because to prove, you know, that they're, you know, and that's where there's a danger. And a lot of, you know, and now I can speak from my internal medicine, you know, in the real treatment of people, tests don't have that much weight in terms of, but you still got to treat, you know, a test might be an answer, but it's not a solution. I just like to stress that point because I don't want everyone to, I think, so, because of when you're suffering, you hear something and there's a test, and it could easily make us all run and get a test. But sometimes a test, it doesn't necessarily change the outcome of anything, except now we're talking about in the insurance world it does, unfortunately. So there might be some benefit there. And so who knows where it could lead down the, you know, that this test might lead to more solutions. That's very possible. And I would hope so. But
slippery slope.
Again, it still doesn't, it's not an immediate, this is not something we could immediately take and go, you know, aha, did we get the test? You know, because we all, that comes up also with the CRPS, you know, there is a, you know, in the affected limb, there's osteoporosis in that area. You know, the mechanisms are, to me, a little bit not clear cut. Is it because of disuse of the limb, or is there something about the blood flow that altogether with the osteoporosis? And of course, now that's leading to the idea of looking at osteoporosis drugs to treat CRPS, which I don't know the outcome yet, because I think there's some small studies on it, but that's fascinating to see. So there's, so sometimes that's where a test could lead to a solution, bring it up. If not, please, don't even let us know about it until there's something, a benefit that could come from it.
Yeah.
You know, otherwise I think we're already tested. Has anyone in here ever gotten a diagnostic test? Maybe a few, and unfortunately, for all the tests we get, it doesn't always turn out to be beneficial.
Okay, another question?
Yeah.
Marla?
I had a successful on their trial.
Yes, I do. Hello?
Failing insurance and spreading on the insurance. Just wondering, it's been a while since I've been in my trial.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you guys have come up with that was like a magic bullet, a magic thing to say to an insurance company?
Well, I can tell you that if it's got to be anything that's said, it's got to be said by us, like me specifically. I'm not sure if I got a letter out.
You got a letter out to me, yes.
And that went to the insurance?
Since then, we've changed. We're still with the same company, just different policies.
I'll tell you what, you know, honestly, it's me. I gotta write it. And so I got to know who to because that's the only way to do it is to you got to kind of plead the case. If they're not accepting of, you know, right off the bat, if it's denied, that's where we start. You're right. The progress, you know, and there is progress. So get me back involved, okay? And let me know.
I agree with Dr. Mitch Moore. I think that you're your best advocate. And that's great. Dr. Mitch writes you a letter.
Yeah.
It's fantastic to have your doctor write you a letter and support you, but you are your absolute best advocate. I never recommend that anybody rely on their clinic to advocate for them. I mean, I love Dr. Mitch. He's my doctor, and it's fantastic if he supports you or your doctor supports you, but you are your best advocate. I don't care if your insurance company tells you no. You fight that. You appeal that, you fight that. I know, Marla, I've told you this before, but I'm telling everybody, fight that. Fight them in their own language. Insurance companies don't really care what's best for you. They don't care if you're getting better. They don't care if you're not getting better. They don't care what worked. They don't care what didn't work. They care about their bottom dollar. They care if they're making money, if they're saving money, if they're spending money. So go at them with everything they've already spent. You've spent this much money. You're willing to spend this much money. This is the treatment I want to have, and this is what it costs, and it's cheaper than what you're spending. This is how I can save you money, and I demand to have it. I mean, you are their customer, and the customer is right. Most people, especially in chronic pain, they think that they're at the mercy of their insurance company, and that's not how it works. You need to demand the treatment that you want. Go at them armed with the dollars and cents, and demand it.
And what part of the armamentarium that might be a letter from you? I agree with you.
We're on the same page.
This isn't my letter isn't to say you shouldn't advocate at all. That's part of your advocacy. Use that in your armamentarium.
We're on the same page. Get a letter from your doctor. That's fantastic.
That's part of
but
it.
But don't only rely on that. Fight for yourself.
Right.
A lot of doctors are months, so they won't write the letter. So in my case, if I need a letter from a doctor, I'll write the letter for him and have him read it, make any changes he needs, and sign it. So it saves him time, and I advocated for myself with my doctor's help.
Well, I have been collecting articles and everything to send in other packets.
That helps too. Send your
absolutely.
Doctor all the information you can about the treatment that you want to have. Hey, this is what I want to do. If you're not educated on this particular treatment, here you go. I'll help educate you. I'll save you the time. You don't have to do the research.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
If your doctor won't like a letter for you. Will you still see?
Right, so actually what I'm talking about is, as at Spiro where we do the treatment, you know, I write letters on behalf to the insurance company to try to advocate for coverage. I mean, obviously, you know, that's in everyone's best interest. And so, and it's what they should do. But the way insurance companies say no till they have to say yes.
Yes.
I mean, I think everyone, think of it this way. They have this big pile of money that you pay them. And their job is to hang on to as much of it. Nothing personal. This is just the way it is. Okay. So you got to pry away. That's how they view it. You got to pry away that money. There's certain things. There's certain rules about how that money gets pried away. That don't have a lot to do with your personal experience or your suffering. Unfortunately, that's just the way the game. It's not a game, but it's played like that. Okay. But there is the science. There is the science to back up something like Calmair that is convincing insurance companies that they got it, that this fits the rules for coverage. You see, on their, I'll never look at insurance companies, okay? But imagine if, though, you're an insurance, you know, you're asked to pay for something. It's reasonable to want to know that there's proof that it works, and that there's an outcome, and that there's going to be a return on that investment. That's all. And so, those are the types of, when dealing with insurance companies, that's the language, okay, is where's the, show there's a return on investment, that's really what it's about. Personal testimonies, it will affect any human being, but you're not talking to human beings when you write those letters. You don't even get a human being to sign a letter, you get a department, okay, it's very impersonal. So they need to know value. We gotta speak like that, you know, and that kind of language.
They have to type it. The person that's sitting at the desk that sends you the letter,
yeah,
that you can't have, it doesn't even have a medical background.
Or possibly a high school diploma for that matter, but still not, there's still a way to make it happen. So believe me, I know your frustration. I feel it in many ways.
Marva?
You mentioned that some people don't respond to the Calmair treatment. And you also mentioned that it was similar to TIMS units. Do you find a connection between those who respond positively to TIMS and those who respond
to TIMS? No. So I think that's a great question and not an uncommon one. But I want to make sure I'm clear on it. This is absolutely not a TIMS. The only thing, see, being an internist, I can make other analogies. So, you know, there's inhalers for asthma. And yet the medicine that one inhales could be completely different. So there's certain inhalers that do nothing to open a person up, but they treat some other aspect of the asthma. You know, so the only thing they have in common is that they're both inhaled. So people might commonly mistake one for another, and that could be a very costly mistake if they reach for the wrong inhaler at the wrong time. So the fact is the TENS unit has electrodes, and we hook them up in some way to try to relieve pain. So does Calmair. But they are. That's where the similarity stops, and they are completely different in terms of what they do. So whereas TENS really does not go and change up the way the brain perceives that limb over a long period of time, it only changes the situation while those electrodes are on, because actually it's stimulating another type of nerve fiber that while it's on, it's almost like if you ever had pain and you dug a fist into it, kind of hurts so good, you know, they're feeling, right? Well, that kind of thing is actually the same, similar mechanism of what we're doing with a TENS unit. You're kind of making, you're giving it a little bit of a different type of signal that isn't as painful. It's comforting while the thing is on, but as soon as you take it away, pain comes back. That's Calmair, completely different. It not only will intercept that pain, tell the brain it's, you know, not really there, and then over time the brain then takes it on permanently or in a more permanent way. So there's no correlation. Someone could have gotten TENS and it worked a little bit, and that you know, or it didn't work at all. There's no bearing on what the prediction is for your, you know, response to the Calmair. I think the best predictor of response to Calmair is the underlying diagnosis and what the cause of the pain is, and neuropathic, true neuropathic pain seems to be the type of pain that responds the best to Calmir, because it works right within the mechanism of how of neuropathic pain and the brain, you have this certain relationship that Calmir seems to disrupt very well.
Thank you.
Well,
Kathleen? I was just going to say what you said. I totally agree with what you said about advocating for yourself. And I had just gone to my doctor. We talked about the Calmir, we talked about ketamine. And he said, you know, either way, if you run into the problems with the insurance, you need to, just like what you said, speak their language and tell them you've spent close to, you know, $1 million in 20X years. You know, look at how much this costs in comparison. And he said that, you know, as far as he knows, that that has a best outcome also. So,
anyone else?
Along that same line, helping Nancy with things, talking to the insurance companies, I always try to find the same lady, even though that's difficult. I get a name every time I call. Friday at 4:45, and then, you know, if they say no, which they always do, I've said things like, okay, so you're giving me permission to take her to the emergency room instead of the pool for physical therapy, because she's having a flare-up. You know, that balance of the emergency room treatment versus the please write, sign off on physical therapy, you know, and that's what.
Okay. One last question, anyone?
A lot of more states are legalizing marijuana, and I just want to know what your thoughts are about medicinal marijuana, since it's not, I believe, legal in the state of Illinois. I mean, I don't know if it's been.
Yes, it is. The law has passed, but it's kind of still not ready for prime time. I think they haven't worked out like where the dispensaries are, who's going to be allowed. So, yeah, it's legal, and I just look at it like everything else. I prescribe, I'm going to know everything I can about it and see if ever in my dealings with patients who aren't well, if I think there's a place for it, I'm going to prescribe it like anything else.
It's legal in our states,
yeah.
It's not legal in Wisconsin, I just
in Arizona, I'm finding, I've never used it in any form. But I'm finding from my friends that use it that smoking it doesn't help as much as edibles or tinctures. So I think it depends on what pain you have, what strand of marijuana you're getting.
There's a lot
of variables as to if it's going to help, and then how you eat it and how much you eat and all of that matters as well.
And there's you know, more and more information coming out online. Support groups, but there's so much more information about it online. And when you're, you know, people are having a difficult time, again, from a coping perspective, like they may have decided, I'm never going to try that ever, I couldn't even tell anybody ever, and then, you know, dealing with maybe that's the only thing that's working for them, and that brings up this whole other realm of life for them, because it's, you know, whether it's the shame, because this is the only thing that's working for me. I mean, that could be about opiates, it could be about any type of medication. But it's not something to take lightly, even if it does work, you know, in processing through, how do you feel about it? Well, how do you feel about it becoming a superior? You know, whether, regardless of how they prescribe it. And go slow. Go slow. If you're trying anything, go slow. And remember, you're a human being, you know, trying to do a whole lot.
It's a big subject.
It's a big subject.
Okay. I'd like to thank everyone for coming, and thank you to all of our online participants. Here at the Holiday Inn in Rosemont, Illinois, the Power Pain Midwest Neuropathic Pain Treatment Education Expo. The videos from today and all the handouts from each of the presenters today will be available on the Power Pain website after November 1st as part of the November projects. Thank you to all of our exhibitors in the back, Competitive Technologies, doTERRA, KevMed Pain Shield, Lupus Society of Illinois, Medtronic Neuromodulation, Power Pain Foundation, of course, RSDSA, Rush University Medical Center, Spiro Pain Relief Therapy of Illinois, the Neuroscience Center, Hyperbaric Centers of Chicago, Whole Foods Northbrook, Also, thank you to our financial sponsors for providing the funding for this event so that it can be offered for free to everyone. That's Competitive Technologies, John Webb, KevMed Page Shield, Maria's Fund, NeuroLumen, RSDSA, Medtronic Neuromodulation, Spiro Pain Relief Therapy of Illinois, the Neuroscience Center, Hyperbaric Centers of Chicago. Please remember that the exhibitors will be here for a while longer, and if you haven't stopped by, please stop by and see them. To today's presenters, exhibitors, funders, and attendees, thank you all for your participation in today's event and making the Power of Pain Foundation turn pain into power.
Thank you.
Gracie did an amazing job putting this together. And she worked tirelessly to do this. And we really appreciate the work that she put into this to make it such a success. So thank you.
Thank you, Gracie.